In this screencast, we will take advantage of the use of transfer functions in order to determine a good start for tuning parameters for a process. So in this screencast, we'll look at a system with given transfer functions for the valve, sensor, transmitter, and process. And what we want to do here is develop tuning parameters for a PID controller. So provided on the right-hand side is a table of the Ziegler-Nichols tuning parameters. So for a PID controller, we would want to take advantage of this row. So just a few important things to remember about Ziegler-Nichols. One is that the two variables of interest here are KCU, which is the ultimate gain, and P sub U, which is the ultimate period. Experimentally, the ultimate gain and ultimate period can be found using the continuous cycling method. And in the continuous cycling method, you are running your controller as only a P-only controller, and your goal is to get a response that is undamped. However, if transfer functions are known, if we can model the process, the valve, and the sensor transmitter with good accuracy, if the transfer functions are known, we can find KCU and PU, the ultimate gain, ultimate period, via the method of direct substitution. So that is what we're going to take advantage of in this situation. So recall that direct substitution involves an analysis of the characteristic equation, which is 1 plus the open loop gain, which equals 0. So with the characteristic equation, we'll have 1 plus GV, GM, GP, and the controller. So we'll substitute those transfer functions into our characteristic equation. The important point here for the controller is that even though we're looking for a PID controller, we have to assume that when we're doing this analysis, that GC equals KC. And the reason why is because the continuous cycling method, which is used for the ultimate gain, the ultimate period, runs on only a P-only controller. So therefore, in order to complete that analysis, we have to assume that our controller is as such. So from here, we can do a little bit of math. So the next step in direct substitution is we let S equal I omega. And then we'd be substitute that in for all our values here for S in the equation. We then take advantage of the fact that the imaginary I squared equals negative 1. What we then do here is we break this into the real and imaginary part, for we have some terms which have I in it and we have some terms that do not. The important point here is that since the right-hand side equals 0, the real part of the equation and the imaginary part of the equation must equal 0. Our real term has two variables in it, omega and KC, but our imaginary term only has one variable, omega, so we will solve for that. If we move one of the terms over, we'll end up with 10i omega cubed equals 8i omega. One of the omegas drops out, it's 0, it's a negligible answer for this. Having a frequency of 0 doesn't really help anything. The i's will cancel, so this leaves us with omega squared equals 8/10, or that omega is the square root of 8 over 10, which is approximately 0.894. So that gives us our omega value. This here represents the ultimate frequency. So we can then find the ultimate gain using the second equation. So using the real equation, we'll have negative 17 times 8 over 10, which is omega squared, plus 1, plus 4kc equals 0. So after some math, we see that kc, in this case, this would be the ultimate gain, equals 3.15. So we have found the ultimate gain. Now, in order to find the ultimate period, we take advantage of the relationship between the ultimate gain and the ultimate frequency, which is 2 pi over omega. So this will be 2 pi over about 0.894, which will be 7.03, and this will have units of minutes because of the fact that our time constants had units of minutes. So with our values of the ultimate gain and the ultimate period found, we can now use the table we showed at the beginning in order to find our parameters. So therefore, the KC value, how you would begin to control the system for the P standpoint, represents the ultimate gain divided by 1.7. So this would be 3.15 divided by 1.7. And when that division is done, we have 1.85 The units are generally percent controller output over percent transmitter output, although that can depend based on some of the units you have for your transfer functions. Tau I is the ultimate period divided by 2. So this will be 7.03 divided by 2. And that'll be 3.515 or 3.52 minutes. And the derivative time will be the ultimate period divided by 8, or 7.03 divided by 8, which is 0.879 minutes. So an important point to note here is that these parameters are not the be-all and end-all and the perfect parameters for this process. These tuning parameters serve as a starting point for our analysis in terms of where we want to potentially begin the tuning scheme. Another important issue here is that this is tuning parameters for a Ziegler-Nichols, which assumes that the desired response is a quarter decay. So therefore, if quarter decay is not exactly what you want, you could potentially use a whole host of other tuning parameters and correlations, taking advantage of various landmarks about some combination of your actual process, your sensor transmitter, your valve, and potentially your controller. So in this screencast, we showed how we can use transfer functions to use the Ziegler-Nichols method in order to determine a good start for tuning parameters to control your process.